In case you haven't noticed it, there is a little indicator on your screen on the bottom left that allows you to play back these audio comments and slides at different speeds. So that if I'm speaking too quickly or too slowly for you, or you're reviewing and you want to buzz through things, you have access and the ability to manipulate that. Again, I think most of you know this already, but just in case, check out the 1X little icon on your screen. Click on that or tap on that and see what happens. Hi, everybody. So we're going to keep talking about timbre today and continue on and bridge to the topic of texture. So as of the end of last time, we've been given a lot of different types of sounds, instruments, concepts to be able to orally ID. So this is going to be centered around different ways to help identify them. I'm going to give you five different ways to identify a sound to help tease them apart from each other so that they seem more distinct rather than just kind of like this blurry cloud of, you know, somewhat familiar sounds that you can't further differentiate. Some of these methods are going to work better than others for you. I still want you to be aware of the terms that are thrown out there, which will be on the screen when you come across them. But ultimately, for identifying the sound, whatever works for you works for me. Approach that we have already been using was the one that I wanted you to start with in your listening journal, which is recording your initial unguided reactions to sound. And now we're going to check out the second approach. Something to think about with this is that, again, I'll acknowledge that we're using a lot of kind of Western orchestral instruments, and I have a couple reasons that this might serve useful for you. One is that they provide a basis of comparison for other sounds that you may be less familiar with. To a varying degrees, these are instruments that you would have seen coming up in your education programs in school. And they can, because let's be honest, the number of instruments in the world that you potentially would have to be able to identify is kind of staggering. And that, I know the list that you got of informations to be able to identify by ear already seems like a long list, but I myself feel like I should, and I'm using that word for myself, be able to identify 1,000 instruments by ear. So just to dip our toe in the pool of the different possible instruments to identify, we're starting with the ones that culturally in America, in the West, we would more likely be familiar with, provides a basis for comparison. And I've linked to this slide, the Young Person's Guide to the Orchestra, which is a composition that feel free to listen to it. It's in its entirety, or kind of skim through. It's one of a type of piece that is orchestra with narration, and it's a great performance video that you'll be able to see so that you can start to, you know, have a clearer picture of how the sound is produced. The Britain or Prokofiev's Peter and the Wolf, which we heard the bassoon excerpt of, and another more modern composer, George Kleinsinger, they all have pieces of orchestra with narrator that serve to introduce instruments kind of as characters in a story. And so if that seems to make sense to you as like how a given sound will fit into a narrative, that might be a good method to follow.
ancient ancestors who lived in caves experimented with the sounds of stones and pebbles, shells and sticks and gourds and bones, and heard the music of the wind and waves. Eon followed eon. Here we are. We've learned a lot about the different ways to make exciting sounds, and nowadays we've all the riches of the orchestra. Percussion. You can bang or brush or tap. Instruments with strings to pluck or bow. And some, the woodwind and the brass, to blow. Each with a clever woman or a chap who practiced for long hours year after year while they were growing up. Their dedication deserves our gratitude and admiration, and I suggest you give them all a cheer. The poem's nearly over. Now they'll play a lovely tune by Henry Purcell, who was English. And a great composer too. Long dead, still entertaining us today. First you'll hear it played by all the team. Four groups of instruments together, then each group will play the melody again. You'll go out humming Henry Purcell's theme. Instrument in turn will play a variation on Purcell's theme to help you learn. Enjoy your education. Woodwind are the first to go, the flute and then the piccolo, the oboes and the clarinets. Then everyone sits back and lets the big boys have a chance to show what they can do. Bassoons, they're low. Thank you. the strings. This part begins with music from the violins, next violas, then the cellos, followed by those grunty fellows, double basses. Then, in sharp contrast, we hear the singing harp. The horns will start, then the trumpets stir the heart. Next trombones, long and thin. Watch the slides, go out and in. The tuba joins in for a while. Ah, tubas, don't they make you smile? Time. Here come the timpani, the big bass drum. The xylophone will join the throng, the castanets, the shining gong, plus some I haven't room to name, but you will hear them all the same. We've taken it apart, and now we're going to reassemble it. That's not too hard. They all know when to start, and the conductor helps them out a bit. They're going to play a fugue. The piccolo will pipe a theme, and then you'll hear it played by other instruments, some high, some low. They'll weave their voices into a brocade. And then, to add a further complication, the brass play Purcell's theme. Tunes dance around each other in a final celebration of all the riches of the world of sound. ¶¶
Na, da muss doch der Musikunterricht richtig Spaß machen. Großer Beifall an der Royal Albert Hall für diese aufgemöbelte Version von The Young People's Persons Guide to the Orchestra von Benjamin Britten. Nicht die Musik hatte es möglich, aufgemöbelt zu werden. Die war immer toll, aber offenbar nach dem Eindruck der BBC oder zugehörige Erzähl- und Erklärtext.
Our second approach is going to involve associating the sounds that you hear with a level or altitude or part of the body. So we're talking about range. So rather than talking about specific timbre, we're going to talk about where in the different body parts you might kind of interface or connect with a given sound. And so if we start on the bottom, we look at foundational types of sound. So low range percussion is what happens on this graphic here, to be indicated here. So bass drum, timpani, or what is known as kettle drums, taiko drums. If you're checking out Japanese style drumming, there the shimidaiko is the super ginormous drum that you'll see in Japanese style drumming. That anything that could potentially shake the earth, right? You're going to connect with it first in your lower body, and then you can start to associate the higher ranges of sounds with places higher up on your body. And so as you listen to the different instruments, see where they strike you, and then compare them to this list. Your individual results may vary. A third approach to identifying a sound may work better with some types of instruments rather than others. But again, the more creatively you can identify with something, it doesn't matter if it's actually true, as long as it helps you identify with it. But this approach is to picture how an instrument or the player of the instrument produces the sound, right? Now, I've included a link on this slide to an acoustic guitar piece that is called Drifting. And just as an example of how many different timbres one instrument can produce, and seeing it being played, I think changes your reaction and your relationship to the instrument, because it expands what you are aware that the instrument can produce. So identifying with the player to some degree or another, this is a concept that one of your colleagues brought up during class, can potentially be helpful in nailing down what exact sound, what instrument, what voice you're hearing. For our fourth approach, we're going to use a little bit more of a dissection of each sound. And this really serves to put them on equal footing. If any of you have ever done any sort of audio editing, you'll recognize this image right here, this waveform image. And we're going to actually talk about what to look for within this. This is just a little bit of a heads up for your fall senior year music curriculum. This is going to come in a lot more relevance as we get into audio editing when we talk about that. Now, with that last image that you saw, that was most likely an image of a song or a piece of music, a recording with multiple sounds going in it. But this image that you see on this slide illustrates the four parts of a sound, any one of which could be unique to a given instrument and help give away its identity if you listen carefully. This is something that certainly rewards close listening. Just a quick explanation of what you're seeing here. So if you look on the y-axis, that is the up and down, I believe, if I remember my math courses from decades ago properly. So amplitude just has to do with volume, how strong things are. So the higher and lower, consequently, that the wave is, the more or less sound you're going to be hearing. And then left to right is time, or the x-axis is going to be time, so length. And so there's proportion of how long each of these portions of the sound lasts. So the names for the beginning, middle, and end essentially are the attack and decay, that's the beginning, the sustain, which is the middle or the body, and the release, which is how the sound fades away. You can abbreviate them ADSR. Just a quick note, this is not to be confused with ASMR, which is audiosensory meridian response. That's a totally different thing. But in case you feel like those four letters ring a slight bell, just want to differentiate that, and you can look that up on your own to see what that is. But ADSR, that's our little acronym we're going forward. And again, you most likely, if you ever happen to go into an audio editing program, you're more likely going to encounter this with respect to songs rather than individual sounds. But we're going to imagine that you have the ability to do this, at least mentally, with individual sounds as well. So for the attack and decay, and I group them together because I think of them as the beginning of it. They come together in a package deal, sort of that they form the identity of the beginning of the sound, the front, the bite. If you're singing, your consonant that you choose, whether it's a k or a t or a m or b, those will all determine how much of a sharpness that the beginning of the sound has. As you might imagine, percussive sounds and percussion instruments are mostly about the attack, and even the sustain is almost non. It's very hard to pick up, and it's more about the release and how the sound goes away. We'll get to releasing, but the decay is how you bridge to the body of the sound, and we're going to talk a bit more about why the attack and decay were an important development in how sounds were engineered, especially as people started to create artificial sounds. Talking about bridging attack and decay into the sustain, if you look at these two instruments here, all I did was I looked for waveforms. That's the name of this type of picture. Waveforms of, I searched for clarinet and snare drum. And so you can see that with the amplitude or the loudness of the sound as it progresses. And we don't even have to say that these are both the same length of time in seconds, but it's more like you get a profile of the sound, however it's going to last, that our decay on that top one goes right into the sustain. And so it, like, you get a front to the sound and it tapers just slightly. You get that little lip, and then you can hold the sound and it maintains its integrity, the sustain, the body of the sound, for however long you want to hold it. The bottom one is, if you can see, is the first sound is certainly the sharpest sound. And if you look carefully at the front of the clarinet sound versus the snare drum sound, you'll see that the clarinet, there's a little bit of swelling into it, where versus the snare drum, you know, there's that little scuff in there. But otherwise, we're talking about a very sharp start when there's nothing and then there's something, as opposed to here's a little hint, here's the something. And then if you look at the snare drum sound here, you'll notice that there is no horizontal portion. It's always getting softer. Now, this could be what we call a diminuendo, and we'll talk about that in a little bit when we talk about musical texture. But if we're talking about just a single note from a single instrument, we're talking about one that has no sustain and that is from the very beginning just going away. Now, it's going away pretty smoothly. It doesn't, there's no drop off necessarily, but we can never go back. We can't get loud, it looks like. And so when you're listening for instruments and trying to kind of characterize them, that's one thing that you can think of, like how much in any one given note can you hear a plateau versus when it starts to go away. Most of what we're hearing in music is indeed the sustain portion of a given sound. If you think about it, those attacks are pretty darn quick. And unless you're listening to only drumming music, you're going to have long sounds. If you're listening to someone singing, the long sound is identifiable because it's the vowel. You can't really sustain, for example, the letter T. Like it's all the attack, and as soon as you start it, you can't continually start it unless you. But that those are repeated sounds, not really a single sustained sound. Versus A, E, I, O, U, and all the variations of those vowels. I apologize for my singing voice, but all the vowel variations that you can do and kind of shape. How the sound comes across, depending on which vowel you're singing. But that is more of the sustain that we're going to be talking about. For string players, we could use a bow for sustaining. Aerophones will use their breath, right? As you know, their lung power and the volume of their lungs will indicate how much potential sustain there is. And there's even a thing called circular breathing, which I can maybe look up a demonstration and post it for you within this, but it's where the player will simultaneously breathe in and out. And so they can produce extremely long notes. There's a world record for the longest unbroken sustained note, something like 45 minutes. And at a certain point, it becomes like the guy's getting dehydrated and he's already proved it. Like, I think it was Kenny G, the kind of smooth jazz saxophonist / punchline that you may have heard of before. But for wind players, and that's a very specialized technique that not every wind player can do, but circular breathing, that is. But for everybody else, just the contents of your lungs in a single breath is going to determine your sustain. And then percussion instruments, that's the entire reason that the roll or the tremolo exists, is to hold out a note. On an earlier demonstration and discussion video, I demonstrated a snare drum roll, but those exist on any instrument. Basically, we're just trying to make the sound not quit. And with percussion, what we're doing is we're trying to overlap the attack in the minimal sustain that an instrument might possess to fool your ear into imagining that a constant sound is happening. But if you choose to acknowledge it, you can also hear the individual sounds, unless the acoustics don't allow it, or unless the player is extremely good. And that's one of the things that the players will seek to achieve, is a roll that sounds just as good as pure sustain. An issue in early synthetic sounds or synthesized sounds is that when someone, say, wanted to create an electronic piano sound, or more to a point, an electronic violin or brass sound, they only really concerned themselves with how the sustain sounded. And so once you were like holding down a key for a synthesized violin sound or trumpet sound, it would sound okay, but you kind of had to disregard the front, the attack. The attack was not paid as much attention to. Maybe it was a limitation in early technology when people were getting electronically generated sounds going, and there wasn't enough RAM or processing capability to handle that type of a complex sound. Things are getting better now, but if you listen to older synthesized instrument sounds, it's kind of cringeworthy how much they ignored everything except for the sustain. And finally, we have the end of the sound, the release, the letting go of the sound. This is at the very tail end. This is how the sound disintegrates as the note goes away. So it's not just that the note goes away, but does the note become thinner sounding as it also becomes quieter and more distant sounding? The release, depending on the type of instrument, and we'll go back to our organology categories, the release can be controlled by some instruments, specifically aerophones and bowed string instruments. They can control exactly how the sound goes away, when it goes away, and with what shape on this little amplitude graph it goes away. Anything else where you're relying on passive resonance, where something is vibrating, either struck, plucked, strummed, you can't really, you can affect how long it takes, but you can't affect, you can't slow it down. You can only speed it up, meaning you can make the sound go away a little sooner, but you can't make it take longer, and you can't make it stronger until the very end, save if you just stop the sound early. So for a single struck note on a gong, I can hit that instrument and let it sustain, and the release will take as long as that instrument naturally wants to, but I can't really do anything. Once it's happened, you can't unring a bell, so to speak. The release has a lot to do with the acoustics of a room and how much reverb naturally you're going to get. The release can be the part that happens to the sound once the environment takes hold of it. So if you're in a very, you know, hard space, like a cathedral, you know, some stone building with stone walls, you can have extremely long release times. You can have, you know, 4 or 5 seconds before the room is completely silent again, just from a single sound. And doing that just makes, especially when you have a lot of overlapping sounds, it makes individual sounds harder to distinguish. And so what you end up doing to compensate in spaces that have a lot more of an extended, oh, I noticed there's a little typo in there that says decay, but extended release in a performance spaces that, as you might imagine, you have to exaggerate the attack of the next note. You know, it has to call attention, more attention to itself in order to compensate for all the extra ambient leftover release that's in the room. So just to bring us back to these two graphs of two different sounds, if you look for the release, you'll see the one on the left, it looks like a very deliberate moment when the release happened versus in the beginning of to the end of the one on the right, it was an inevitable release. Like it was unavoidable. And that the sound was always releasing. You could think of this in some ways as basically just attack, decay, release with no sustain to it. That is one way to hear a sound. There are a few electronic effects and ways to manipulate sound that we've already talked about, and a couple that we haven't yet talked about that it's helpful to be able to identify them in part by how they affect the four parts of the sound: attack, decay, sustain, release. Distortion tends to blend things together in terms of the attack, decay, and sustain. So you get less of a sharpness at the very beginning, and it kind of morphs into a single entity. So if you go and listen to that distortion demonstration I did just by overdriving the mic in that last video, you can do that. Or you can listen to how electric guitar loses its pluckiness as soon as you apply distortion to it. It does also tend to extend the release. So as you listen to, electric guitar, like you'll notice that the sound takes longer to go away. We have the kind of flanger, phaser, or sometimes what's called an envelope filter, spacey and kind of changing of focus of the sound. That's an effect. I'll link to a demonstration of that. Reverb we talked about before, and we talked about how the size of the virtual room or the actual room can be have a huge effect because of the reverb and how the sounds intermingle with each other. Modern recording studios have absolutely no reverb. That's like, you know, you'll go into what feels like a closet with egg crate foam all around them and no ventilation ducts for any sound to like exit or enter the room. And those are designed in part to eliminate sound leaking from outside and also to eliminate sound bouncing around so that it can then be purely manipulated electronically. Although early recording studios were famous for their sound because of the way the natural reverb was constructed. And you still do have certain performance venues that are constructed with their acoustics in mind so that you can, so to speak, hear a pin drop from the other side of an entire auditorium. We also talked about delay. Since we're kind of cloning the sound here, delay doesn't affect these in the same way that it doesn't really target any one of these. So that's where it's, you know, just to put it up there with the rest of the effects that we've talked about or I'm talking about now, just so you know that not everything has a massive effect. The reverse effect, so that you're basically taking the waveform and putting the attack last, is a very interesting way. And if you imagine, all of those reversed sounds will have at least a slight swell to them because the attack is going to be mostly louder than the sustain and certainly louder than the release. You have a what sometimes is called a granular effect. Digital music is called that because it's chopped into digit, you know, if we go all the way down to the base level binary code, but it's chopped into bytes, bits. And just like, you know, resolution on an image can go up or down, and the quality and focus of that image can, and the clarity of that image can go up and down. This can actually be a useful effect to invoke a sort of quality change, especially impact when the full sound quality kicks in. But the number of these bits or bytes per second is what we're talking about. And so you can have something deliberately be low res, so to speak, or a low what's called sampling rate. And again, we'll talk more about that in your fall course. You can have something be low res, or you can have something be clearly in focus. And the use of this reduction of sound quality is a useful effect when you want to draw attention to a change in atmosphere. And then we have auto-tune, which you may have heard of before, which was originally developed as something to help detect earthquakes. It was a seismic thing. And then somehow it was turned into a device to correct minor pitch intonation issues. So if something was slightly out of tune, the auto-tune effect could be applied, and it would nudge the note back into tune. You know, we talked a while ago about A equals 440. Well, sometimes, you know, people miss that mark. And auto-tune is an effect that, when done in its original musical application, was not supposed to ever be detected, but has since then become much more prevalent when it's overset. And I'll post something so that you can hear an example of what auto-tune. So we've discussed electronic effects just before, and we've talked about the environment, but what else, and I want you to add a comment with your thoughts before you go on, what else contributes to the quality, the timbre of a given sound, instrument, or type of music? Let me know what you think. Add a comment.
So let's stop and think about what contributes to the sonic thumbprint of an instrument, the timbral quality of it. So, and we're talking acoustic instruments here, because as soon as we go into the electronic realm, then really the sky's the limit, because we're not dealing with physical constraints so much as software and processing constraints, and those don't have nearly the types of boundaries. It's much more bounded by human ingenuity than it is of these other factors that you see here. So the available materials, you'll find that different woods, for example, if we're talking about the frame for drums or other instruments like that, depending on the different woods, you'll have a different quality of instruments, you know, sturdiness, loudness, size. And therefore, you know, if you imagine if you don't have wood that permits to construct large drums, then you don't have low sounding drums quite as much. If you have the ability to make pottery, then you have the ability to make ceramic drums like a darbuka, something like that. Then there's, you know, different animal skins, like the calf skin versus goat skin on a drum sound different. If we're talking about that, and metals, you know, what are we talking about? You know, just like a piece of crude iron. Are we talking about a brass instrument that requires a little bit more, you know, more ingredients? And this dovetails nicely into what does the technology allow? Real quick side story. So everybody's familiar with the instrument, the piano. It's a very practical instrument for reasons of, you know, it has basically all the musical range that of pitches that humans can really enjoy and internalize on their own. It has all of that laid out for you. The original instrument in that style was actually called a pianoforte. So the word piano, as we're going to study in a little bit when we talk about texture, means soft, or it's a dynamic marking. And the pianoforte literally means soft, loud, or soft, strong. Why is that a big deal? Well, the instruments, the keyboard instruments that preceded it were the pipe organ and the harpsichord. And one thing that you will note about both of those instruments is that they didn't have a dynamic range. No matter how hard you hit the key on the keyboard, it was going to produce the same loudness. And so all of a sudden you get this instrument called a pianoforte that was able to produce different dynamics. And it was a huge development. But it had a drawback, which is if you imagine you have this wooden frame instrument with a lot of strings that are under a tremendous amount of tension. And so just the act of the constructing the instrument meant that you had a lot of stresses that were fighting against each other. And so the instrument as a result had a little bit more of a strained or delicate quality of sound to it. So what does this have to do with technology? Well, then you had, along comes the, you know, Industrial Revolution. We get better in society at refining metals. And so we're able to reinforce the pianoforte with a metal inside interior frame, and we get the modern piano. And I'll include an example of pianoforte versus piano so that you can appreciate the difference between the sounds of those instruments. It's a very subtle difference. But pianofortes are not very common right now, mainly because the amount of tension that the piano wire, the strings inside the piano are under, means that they, you know, they don't tend to be able to last as long. So otherwise, thinking about what technology allows, you know, because of this, what were the first ones? Technology doesn't refer just to electronics. It just refers to the advance of objects and methods by which we solve problems and are able to create things. We as in humans. So because of that, the oldest musical sounds are things that were found objects, stones, logs, seashells, perhaps, anything that had in some way a distinctive sound to it. And of course, the oldest musical sounds will include the voice and body percussion, clapping, being, you know, drumming on yourself. Now think about how that affects your audience. When you use music that's drawn only from those sounds, and we can say just in terms of what we're referring to with respect to the timeline of their invention, primitive, right? They have yet to be developed into further iterations, more advanced versions of themselves. So when you use simpler sound sources, what does that do to your audience? Where does that transport them? To flip that around, when you use sounds that have very clearly been modified, processed electronically, how does that affect your audience? And both of those, how do those affect your dancing? What does it do in terms of the general atmosphere that they create? And of course, another thing that affects timbral qualities, which we don't think of very often, but it affects us literally every day, is just, and this we're back to current day here. We're not talking about primitive or ancient anything, but what speakers are we listening to things on? The playback technology. Are we listening to, you know, your phone speaker? You know, maybe you found a bowl to put it in to amplify it slightly versus a really great, well-designed PA system or speaker system. Those affect timbral qualities greatly. And the irony is that musicians who pride themselves on having distinct, very well-crafted sounds and these soundscapes that they work on, a lot of times will have music that is being listened to on a system that can't reproduce or isn't reproducing all the nuance that they went to all that effort to put into it. That's why, you know, to the best of your ability, if you can, you know, the better the equipment that you're listening to music on, the more of a deep experience you'll be able to get it. Of course, you know that already, but it bears repeating that the playback technology affects how, I mean, that's the last stop before it hits your ears. All the work that's done crafting the instruments, the recording, the file compression that's used if you're listening to digital music, or the recording techniques that you're using if you're listening to vinyl or tape, all those things don't matter if the speaker and the amplifier that, you know, it's being run through aren't well designed and aren't well used. So in the talk about organology, I asked you to pretend you'd never heard of the four sections of the orchestra when we were talking about aerophones, chordophones, membranophones, and idiophones. Now I'm allowing you to recover that memory because we're going to talk a little bit more in practical terms about the four sections. And these are present to some degree or another in any kind of groups. Now, the term up there on your screen right now is the Western Orchestra. And that's one version of it. And that's like perhaps the biggest version of it. But any combination of instruments is going to tend to be arranged along these lines, and including the person who's actually writing the music or arranging music, that like figuring out what instrument is doing what. So we have string section, brass section, wind section. So wind is short for woodwind. And the difference between brass and wind is less to do with what they're made out of and more to do with the exact type of embouchure in producing the sound. And the quintessential example of that is the saxophone, because it looks like it's made out of the same stuff. It looks like it's made out of brass, but it's because it has a reed, a wooden reed on it. It's a woodwind instrument. That's a very common thing. Brass instruments are valved instruments versus woodwind instruments are keyed instruments. So it has to do with how the tubing is opened up and closed off. And so when you're seeing any type of group, and I put the Western Orchestra up there because that's been used a lot so far, but they're arranged or seated into these sections. And then within the string section, for example, there will be subsections, like all the violins will sit next to each other and all the violas will sit next to each other, and all the celli bass, which is the fancy term for cello, plural of cello is celli, all of those will be sitting together. And then, by the way, you also have violins broken into first and second. Real quick, first and second just refer to, you know, kind of lead versus supporting. First is prominent. It's the upper part. It's the soprano to the second violin's alto part, if you will. So think about, why is that? What is the reason? And I want you to type in some comments to see, like, why would that be done? What would be the reason for putting like instruments together spatially when they're performing, and correspondingly also when they're being recorded? What are some other types of musical groups that do that besides that orchestra? And basically, I'm asking you to just, you can even go and Google image for different types of, I just activated my phone by saying that. You can go and look up on the internet with a given search engine, musical ensemble, various musical ensembles. Pick a genre, and then look at the group that's performing it, and look at how they're arranged. And I will be willing to bet that they are going to be sectioned off in this way. So then, on the other side of that, when is that not done? When do you have, you know, a instrumentalist not with other like instruments? Question for you to consider. Add them in the comments before you go ahead, because I'm going to talk about my responses to this. But I love hearing responses to this before I have had a chance to contaminate your thoughts with my answers. I'm really, really curious with that. So before you go on, if you have some thoughts, even if they're quick, go ahead and pop them in there. Okay, so here are my answers. Hopefully you've had a chance to give yourself a moment to think about responses to that. So one, why do similar instruments sit together? Okay, one is logistics. And that has to do with this space constraints, or maybe, and this is like, you know, boring stuff that, you know, might sound like, in, you know, it's not that important, but just it's easier for coordination because you also will have moments where those groups of instruments tend to enter musically, and have certain moments where they need cues from the conductor or from amongst the other members of the group. And it's just easier for them to pass signals amongst each other. And it's also easier for them to tune and make fine adjustments to one another because they're literally close to each other. The closer musicians are to each other to a certain degree, the easier it's going to be for them to melt into each other sonically and match each other. It's also useful for a stereo effect because all of the sound is coming from a specific location. So if you want to have the effect, you know, a multidimensional effect where you have brass sounds coming from one section and you have percussion sounds from coming another part of the stage, you can listen in the stereo field. Some music is recorded this way where you'll be able to hear spatially where they are on stage. And it just helps to complete the picture of how the music is being created. And one of the main reasons that they're grouped together is for the purposes of balance, meaning like, can you hear everything? So we'll talk about the orchestra again. A lot of string instruments. The reason you might have 30 violins is because an individual violin is not a very loud instrument. And so you need a lot of reinforcement, and you only have one person playing crash cymbals. You only have one person playing tuba. You only have, let's say, 4 to 8 people playing double bass, the stand-up bass, right? Because that needs less reinforcement. So, but you have all these groups, and the staging allows for the softer instruments to be closer to the audience and the louder instruments farther away. And that That and the logistics reason are why percussion tends to be in the back, and the more traditionally the instruments that are given the melodic content are a little bit more to the front. They want to make sure that they are foreground, and the stuff that's in background and the color doesn't overpower things. Other groups that do this, I'll just give you a few examples. A great one that I'll give you a little example of, I'll link to, is Indonesian gamelan music. Balinese, Javanese gamelan music is fascinating visually. You know, think of it as a bunch of strung together small tuned gongs and actual what look like gongs. So it's kind of like metallic xylophone looking instruments. I'll attach a picture so that you can see it. But there's a high degree of coordination that's involved in that, and where the players all sit very, very close to each other, and then the people who are doubling on a certain part can all find cohesion to with each other rhythmically. Another thing that everybody's probably been at least somewhat familiar with is marching band. When you see a marching band, because they are spatially separated out a lot more, but you will still see all of the trumpets in one section and all the bass drums in one section. And the more members of one section, so what I mean by section is people who all play the same instrument, the more members of one given section are spread out, the harder and harder and harder it gets, especially when you also get the, you factor in the literally the speed of sound is not quick enough anymore, and you have to start playing things at different times to compensate for how far you away are you way, excuse me, sorry, for how far away you are from your audience. And last one, something, you know, if you look up videos of Duke Ellington, videos of Chick Webb, videos of Count Basie, videos of the Birdland Big Band, any jazz group, jazz orchestra, you'll see that they're also arranged the same way. The difference is that we talked a little bit before about the rhythm section. In the rhythm section, they might seem like disparate, separated instruments. Well, why? You know, the bass and the drums and the piano, those are all different type instruments. Well, in this case, they have a similar musical role, which is to lay down foundational music and supportive music and complementary music for whatever is going to go on top and be like the main part of the composition. So when is this not done? When do you not see like instruments grouped together? Well, when you have groups that are small enough where you don't really have sections anymore, where each instrument, you know, that's one on a part, and it doesn't make sense because there's just not enough, so it's not possible numerically. Another big one is when you have a soloist and you want to draw attention to them, so they are standing out in front of the group, whatever group they're playing with, whether it's a jazz group, it's a singer with a band, or singer with a choir, rather. You know, you'll have a soloist singing out in front versus all the voices behind them. You, like in the classical vein, you'll have the concerto, which is like the one versus the many. It's the heroic struggle of the individual versus the masses. That's kind of the philosophy behind the origin of that genre of quote-unquote classical music. Concerti, the plural of concerto, are still written today. They've taken on very different forms, and you can find a high variety of concerti, but I think a lot of times people think, you know, the Tchaikovsky violin concerto when you hear that term, because it's such a very classical and romantic form, you know, historically speaking. Last, when is this not done? When are like instrument types not grouped together? When staging is more important than the ease of the musician's performance. So, for example, if you have in either musical theater or opera or some kind of performance circumstance where the musician is on the stage, but they're part of a dramatic action, or there's a visual concern that supersedes the need for the musicians to be near each other. In each of these cases, it adds challenge to the performance. It gets tougher to do this because you're farther away from the origin of the other sounds that you are trying to blend with, to complement, to balance with. It becomes much harder to judge your timing, your relative dynamic, your loudness. Your intonation gets harder to adjust to because you have reverb and other things that start to play a bigger part because you are farther from the source and closer to the reflecting surfaces in the room. And not to mention, you know, do you trust your eyes versus your ears when it comes to following a conductor? Because that's not always an obvious thing that you're able to do both. And it has to do with how far apart the musicians are. So these are just factors that go into when music is not being played according to those convenient rules that ensembles really, really prefer to operate by. Okay, now we're going to start talking about musical texture. And I want to make sure that we get past a little bit of very understandable confusion between timbre and texture. Because very often, when people are talking about tone color, it's very tempting to talk about that as the texture of the sound. And I get it, and I make that mistake myself, but I didn't invent the definition of these words. And it's a lot safer to use timbre. Timbre will never be mistaken for anything else. And then texture, as soon as you put it into context, and I didn't say it yet. Texture, think of context, what's going on around it. Timbre doesn't rely on any other factors to hear the color of the sound. Texture is reliant on how many things are going on at once. Think of it that way. So if we go all the way back to the beginning of the course and we talk about timbre is the cinematography, texture is casting. Just to bring that movie metaphor back into play to help rescue some of these definitions from being perhaps too academic sometimes. We'll start with the brass quintet. There's two terms in there. One is brass, which alludes to a certain tone color or sound color or timbre. And quintet refers to a certain number of possible things happening at one time. Up to five things are happening at one time. Five people playing their individual parts. Do you happen to remember what the brass quintet is based on that little fugue, that the little fugue in G minor? Pardon my singing. But can you remember what the five instruments were? And if you can, also, can you list them in score order? This is a little quiz. If you want to see, if you want to pop them in the comments before you go on to the next slide, that would be a good quiz for yourself and, you know, see how accurate you can be. Stay tuned for the answer. So our brass quintet is two trumpets, a first trumpet and a second trumpet. And we know what that means from discussing it before. A French horn, which we have heard already, a trombone, which we've heard already, and a tuba. So that's our brass quintet. Now, why are we talking about this? Well, some combinations, and this is why it's a nice way to bridge the contexts of timbre into texture. Some combinations of instruments are so popular that they became kind of standardized in the way that you'll have, like, you know, certain vocal quartets, like, you know, barbershop quartets or soprano, alto, tenor, bass. Like there are certain standardized combination of instruments that, because of their sound color and the way the instruments work together, And because the texture is unique, I was about to say very unique, but things can't be very unique. They either are or aren't, a pet peeve of mine. And you have these really popular ones, and we're going to talk about a few of them now. So the next one we're going to listen to, and treat this as an opportunity to test your ears. I want you to listen to a little bit of an instrumentation called a piano trio. So this is in the same vein as the brass quintet. A piano trio is another set instrumentation. It is three players, so that's the texture. We have up to three players going on at one time. It is not three pianos. It is three separate instruments. One of them is the piano. But I want you to listen to it before you go ahead. I want you to see if you can identify what all three instruments are to your ear before you go and check your response. So check the next slide for that before you go beyond that.
Thank you.
The next instrument combination that we're going to listen to is the woodwind quintet or the wind quintet. And that's a hint that one of the instruments in particular is actually not technically a woodwind instrument. If you notice our piano trio, by the way, it's violin, piano, cello. Those are the three instruments that you would have heard. For the woodwind quintet, you're going to be able to listen to the next slide. Start it at the given time that I'll indicate in the comment on the next slide. And you'll probably have to listen to it for about 40 seconds to hear everything, all the instruments. You can, of course, listen to it longer, but all of the instruments make their entrances within the first 40 seconds from the time that I say to start it.
Thank you. have an audience today, people. Yes, give yourselves one more round of applause, audience. We are so happy to be here. We are Imani Wins, and to be in this incredible space tonight. This is such a thrill. This is one of our first engagements back, music and art and dance and drama and all the things that we have missed for such a long time is slowly, they are slowly coming back. And so we're so pleased and so grateful that we were asked to be a part of this incredible series. We have to thank Miss Laura St. John and the Atterbury House Sessions. Give her a round of applause. It, again, is just such an honor to be able to play live music. And we hope that through all of our social platforms and through our internet abilities for this evening, we're able to reach you as well. You and you and you and everyone that's out there that has joined us tonight. So, Imani Wins is Brandon Patrick George on flutes. Toyin Spellman-Diaz on oboe. Mark Dover on the clarinet. Kevin Newton is our guest hornist. And my name is Monica Ellis, and I am your bassoonist for this evening. We're going to share with you some pieces that are well within our repertoire, have been for many years, as well as one piece that is brand new to our repertoire that we're really excited to be playing these days. But first, the first piece that you just heard is definitely one that falls in the first category. It was the jazz standard Afro Blue by the Cuban percussionist Mongo Santamaria. Well-known, made popular by so many artists, John Coltrane being one of them, to who knows, everyone else has really covered the tune. And we covered it, decided to cover it some years ago, and it was brought to us by our founding flutist and composer and arranger, Valerie Coleman. So we thank Valerie for that incredible arrangement that has indeed stayed with us for so many years. The next piece that we're going to play is one of these brand new works in our repertoire. We just premiered it last month at the Phillips Collection down in Washington, D.C., and they were the commissioners for it. The composer is the incredible Natalie Joachim. Natalie is famous for her flute work as well as a part of the flute duo Flutronics. And she is just a wonderful, beautiful, thoughtful composer in her own right. Her Haitian-American ancestry is very apparent, and she is informed by that in her writing, most particularly in this piece with storytelling. She wanted to talk to all of us to get a sense about us as individuals before she wrote this piece. And so each of these five movements of this piece represents a little bit of us all, actually. It is called Scene, S-E-E-N, Scene. The first movement is called Mysterious Flowers, and it actually is representative of a family heirloom of Toyin's. The second movement is called This Old House, and that represents my childhood home, which is actually being sold now of 40 years, and the reminiscences. There we go. I always need some help on that one. But what all of the feels that come when you grow up in a place that is no longer your own, but it's very joyous and very sprightly. And then we move on to the third movement, and it's representative of also an heirloom of Brandon's this time. It's entitled Sleeping Baby. The next one, Jeff Scott, our hornist in absentia, is represented in this fourth movement called Grandma's Necklace. And you hear these little tiny bells. It's called Tiny Golden Bells, and it's representative of this heirloom yet again. And the last movement is a part of Mark's family, and it's entitled Empty Space. Now, he has anything but an empty space with, with his family, if I'm correct. That is very true. But he has a new, beautiful, young family, and so the space will continue to be filled. And so it's really kind of a future look on what's to come. So each movement is really a vignette in and of itself. We are just so thrilled to have it in our repertoire now. So without further ado, this is Scene by Natalie Schwachem. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. And thank you to all of you out there for staying tuned in. Now, as I was going through this piece, as we were playing the Natalie's piece, which is so fresh, it's interesting that the music is so personal and means so much to her and to us, because it was literally written for each of us in our heritage. And I think the Villa-Lobos also carries along in that tradition, in that it is literally a piece of his heart and a piece of his mind in the Villa-Lobos Quintet. Heitor Villa-Lobos is from Brazil, but he went at one point to live in Paris and to be part of the whole Parisian compositional scene, which was very Jean Sartre, very très chic, très edified. And he was there studying with a great composing teacher, Nadia Boulanger, and she said to him, as she said to many other people, it sounds like you're writing from your head and not from your heart. And so you need to build some of your heritage into your music. And so this piece, this work, is a prime example of that. The quintet in forma de choros is based on the idea of a choro, which is a Brazilian, specifically Rio de Janeiro, kind of street music. And in that, you kind of, sometimes you have a little battle between two musicians. So there's lots of battles in this, although really, it's all basically a flute concerto, honestly. It's all flute concerto. I mean, I'd like to say, you know, it was more about us, but it's really about the flute. But it's got, it's very, very traditional 20th century music, but at the same time, it's got a little shoulder in there. It's got a little shoulder. And so it's considered one of the masterworks of the wind quintet repertoire. And it's fun to pair it with Natalie's piece, which I think is probably going to be one of those standards soon, in another 10 years. So how amazing to be a part of that trajectory, that continuity of the repertoire of the Wind Quintet. It's an honor to be a part of this ensemble, and I was just thinking that while we were going through Natalie's piece. So here is the masterwork, Heitor Villa-Lobos' Quintet in Forma de Choros. Enjoy.
Thank you. All right. How about for Brandon Patrick George? Killing it. Him especially, but I think we all need a minute before we play the last piece, because that's a lot. I'm sure your ears feel the same way. It's a lot of sound. So I just wanted to take a minute before we play our final tune to really just thank Laura so much for having us. And we're so happy to be here. And it's an honor to play in front of people again, and it's also just an honor to play via the internet, because I think one of the amazing silver linings, to use that term again, for the third time today probably, it's been an amazing experience being able to kind of do this even when there's no one else in the room, and I know nothing can replace live music, but I think we've all learned as a quintet that it's been a lesson for us to kind of look towards the future, because I think live streaming is going to be a vital part of music making for all of us in the years to come past COVID. So thank you. Round of applause for Laura and everyone on the sound. The last piece that we're going to play for you, Dance Mediterranean, by the amazing composer and violinist and oud player Simone Shaheen. It's a piece that we've had in our repertoire since I joined, long before that actually, and it's arranged by our hornist Jeff Scott for the quintet. But it's kind of a piece that Simone would use almost like it's a closer in his own concerts. And his background is that he comes from the Palestinian tradition of folk music, but then also as a classical violinist and composer. And so his you know, influences span so many different genres, but he is really looking kind of in that in-between world between those two sound worlds. So in this piece, it starts off with a beautiful cadenza by Brandon, our flautist, and then it kind of goes into this very lively dance music, and then throughout, you know, about halfway through the piece, we start improvising, and it'll be interesting for you guys to hear where the written music stops and where the improvising starts. And we're kind of improvising on these macombs, which are modes or scales that kind of change between the soloists. And then the rest of us layer on top of that, and then it builds and builds and builds and builds. It's a great end of the concert. And thank you guys so much for being here. This is Dance Mediterranean. Thank you.
So the woodwind quintet, or the wind quintet, we have flute, oboe, clarinet, French horn, which is the one that's technically a brass instrument, but it's kind of like the diplomat of the wind instruments, in that it can kind of melt into wind sound nicely, but it is indeed a brass instrument. So it is in that brass quintet we talked about, as well as this type of quintet. And the bassoon. In that recording that you listen to, the performance, the Imani Winds, you hear the oboe is actually, just full disclosure, the instrument that has kind of a snake charmer type of sound. And by the way, that instrument that you'd hear used is basically an Asian Indian version of the oboe. The one that in that recording is actually what's called an English horn. So it's just a little bit lower in pitch than an oboe, but it's very, very common for oboists to double on that other instrument. Now, the next standardized group is one that I'm not going to make you guess, because we've already talked about it in the organology talk. When we talked about timbre and we listened to violin or string quartet music that was then changed to marimba quartet music. And in this case, we're going to listen to a very, very well-known string quartet composition by an American early to mid 20th century composer, Samuel Barber. It's his Adagio for Strings. There's a high chance that you have heard some of this music before. The most common version was not for string quartet, but the string quartet is the original. And so, yet again, just to review that instrumentation, it's a first and second violin, a viola, and a cello. So the cello is the lowest voice, the first violin is the highest voice. And so we get to hear this piece, and now we're not going to be evaluating timbre anymore. We're going to hear this piece played twice, but the first one is with a string quartet, and the second one is going to be with a string orchestra. So this next slide is our quartet, and we're going to follow it up with a string orchestra.
Thank you.
So now we're going to contrast the original setting of the adagio for string quartet, which you see on the left here, which is for four players, with the string orchestra treatment of that same material. And there are a lot of different arrangements or different settings or different variations on this for all kinds of different instrument combinations. But the string orchestra, as you can see, instead of four players, has over 60. And you automatically will be able to tell the difference as soon as you hear this. If you look at these score samples on the left, you can notice it's written for four parts throughout. And on the right, on the left, we have the quartet, right? And it's a straightforward quartet. On the right, we have violin one, two violin two parts, a viola part, two cello parts, and a bass part. So we have a lot more potential sound going on at any one given time. This is by far the best known version of this composition. And if you don't get an opportunity to do this with any other music that we listen to in this class, if you have a moment, listen to this version with the lights off, with no external stimuli, and see if you can fully immerse yourself in it. And I think you'll get quite a powerful experience out of it. This is a very, very stunning piece of music when you listen to it. Our last somewhat standardized group of instruments, and I say somewhat because it's not exactly standardized, you know, to the exact number of people and the types and number of instruments, and it is the symphony orchestra. I put the word symphony in quotes because I find that's a little bit redundant. Sometimes a different organization will be like the New York Symphony versus the New York Orchestra versus the New York Philharmonic. Those are ways to distinguish different groups. They all refer to the same thing. The word orchestra itself actually refers originally to, I believe, a place on the stage where people would gather. And then it gradually became something where musicians would gather, and then it referred to the musicians. The term symphony, a lot of times when people say, oh, are you going to the symphony? I find that that's a way for people to sound classy. It's not necessarily a term that the musicians or the composers or the conductors, anybody uses, but it's people who want to feel close to the quote unquote class of that genre of music, that they want to, you know, further distinguish themselves by using that term. If you can't tell, it's a little bothersome to me, but that is not as important as knowing that within the orchestra is all of these previous groups. We have a brass quintet, we could use a piano trio. There are pianos inserted into orchestras sometimes. It's not an all the time thing, but when it's called for, it will be wheeled out onto stage and included for a piece of music. Woodwind quintet is there, string orchestra is obviously there. And composers and arrangers who are looking for a particular sound will either augment or replace or omit sounds as they see fit, depending on what they had envisioned for their musical result. Again, it's not fully standard. We generally do have string heavy composition, but for example, the well-known Russian composer, Igor Stravinsky, who you'll be aware of for his composition, his ballets, The Rite of Spring, Firebird, and Petrushka. Those are three big staged ballets that he composed music for. He would very commonly omit strings for a larger portion than the string players themselves were actually used to being omitted for. So you got a larger balance of quote unquote band instruments, you know, band instruments meaning like wind ensemble, a type of group that would have more of its roots in the military, like, you know, parade band instruments, that were turned into concert, you know, seated instruments. So there has always been a little bit of a friendly rivalry between orchestra and band styles. That's just a little thing, you know, an inside musician thing. One little bit of trivia that might be interesting is that there is one instrument that is considered more of a band instrument that is generally not part of the orchestra. So see if you can, on this slide, I want you to comment with what you think that instrument is that's a band only instrument. It's a wind instrument. I'll give you a hint. It's a wind instrument that's in bands, but it is generally not an orchestra, with some exceptions. So to appreciate how the texture of a brass quintet can get blown up into the orchestra, and for all those color changes to end up happening, we listened to the brass quintet Little Fugue when we were first talking about organology in that the previous talk. And now we're going to hear that same composition, but for full orchestra. And I want you to start the next video at 2:07. Something to see if you can identify by ear is when the new instruments come in. Something I'll tell you right now that is interesting is that the brass, which this composition originally belonged entirely to those instruments, are saved until the very end when their instrument's color, you could argue, has much more impact.
Orchestral transcriptions of Bach's organ and harpsichord music are usually made by conductors who are not satisfied with the small amount of pieces Bach wrote for orchestra, to say nothing of the smallness of the orchestras he wrote them for. Now, here are these virtuoso conductors with 100-piece symphony orchestras and no Bach for them to play. So, these conductors reason, let's give them some Bach to play by making big, lavish transcriptions. And these are usually justified by the reasoning that if Bach were alive today with these great overwhelming orchestra machines at his disposal, he would most certainly have given his music the same full treatment. I'm not completely sold on that argument, but many other conductors are, most notably the great and beloved Maestro Stokowski. He has made many Bach transcriptions over the years, and one of the most famous is of this very G minor fugue we just heard. And so here it is again in the grand Stokowski manner. Of course, ideally, a Stokowski transcription should be conducted by Stokowski himself. And guess what? We have been lucky enough to persuade the great maestro to come and conduct it for us in person. We are proud to welcome none other than Leopold Stokowski. Thank you, Maestro. And what a glorious sound that was.
One thing that you'll notice right when you start listening to this is that the tempo is notably slower. And I just want to draw your attention to the fact that this is in a much bigger room. And so they're dealing with reverb and attack and the delay and all of those things we talked about when we talked about acoustics and the environment. So that's one of the things that affects the tempo. And also maybe because the conductor is also the person who arranged this and he enjoyed hearing his own music and wanted it to last a little bit closer to forever, perhaps. But it also, because you have a bigger instrumentation, it can fill up more time. You don't need to get through it as quickly because there's more new sounds coming at you. So it can kind of justify being a little slower. That's my pet theory as to why this tempo is the way it is. So with all this talk about texture, here's a definition for you. If we examine the word organization, that implies, among other things, levels of importance. And the idea is that we're talking about things that are happening at the same time, not over the course of time, but is it one thing or more than one thing going on, and how they relate to each other? So our three basic textures are monophonic, polyphonic, and homophonic. Mono meaning one sound, so there's only one thing going on at a time. Or the Gregorian chant that we listened to earlier would fall under monophonic. Anytime you have a crowd singing, you normally, unless they are all trained singers and know how to harmonize with each other, it's going to be monophonic. There's not going to be any counterpoint or contrasting motion between the different parts or the different voices. Polyphonic, we have more than one part. And if you listen to, for example, like a Bach invention, or when we listen to the When the Saints Go Marching In, and you had the trumpet solo while the clarinetist was soloing, while the trombonist was soloing, and they were all kind of working around each other, where each individual musical line could be deemed as being prominent or important. And then we have homophonic, which is a type of polyphonic or type of polyphony, if you want to use that form of the word, where you still have more than one thing going on, but one is very clearly supposed to be dominant, supposed to take your attention, and the other is supporting. Most music that we listen to falls more in the homophonic category. There is, technically speaking, another type of music called heterophonic, just because I'm slightly academic, so I want to make sure that I'm covering this base, but I honestly don't even understand how exactly to apply the term. So for us, MPH, monophonic, polyphonic, homophonic. Fascinating type of instrument to examine musical texture is the steel drum or the steel pan. In groups, they're referred to as steel bands. This is the national instrument of Trinidad. It is not a Jamaican drum. They're both in the Caribbean, but Trinidad is much further south. And these instruments were originally oil barrels. And you can do a little bit more research. And I talk a little bit about that connection to the oil industry in the next slide. But because they're all made of a 55-gallon steel drum, literally a barrel, and depending on how low you want the notes to go, you have to make them bigger or smaller. So they all have the same timbre. So these steel bands, they blend together perfectly as long as they're well-made instruments. They blend together perfectly, And you'll actually have, if you look at this picture on the screen here, you'll notice that some people are playing a single pan that has kind of a shallow, what they call skirt. So it's not very deep. And then you have some people who are playing groups of two. Some people are playing threes. And I don't think in this picture you have fours, but you have people playing up to six for the bass. So the lead ones are called a single tenor or lead tenor. Then we have double tenor, and we have other pans that are named after other instruments. So we have cello pans and guitar pans, and then we have bass pans. The bass pans, the player stands in the middle, and you'll see a video in a couple slides from now where you'll be able to see the players and the physical nature of this. And because all the instruments have the exact same timbre, because they're all made from the same stuff, it is a perfect way to think of texture and how many things are going on at one time. And truthfully, the music that we're going to listen to is idiomatically written for the steel band. This the beyond the one little performance demonstration you'll see in the next slide, two slides from now, is what's called a panorama arrangement. Panorama is a steel band competition. The big main one is in Trinidad, but there's also one in Brooklyn around Labor Day every year. And if you ever have the opportunity to go to that, please do. Bring some earplugs because it's loud, but go check that out, because there's just nothing like the energy of these ensembles. And it's also just a very creative
it's 11
instrument
o'clock.
In terms of how it was constructed. So just check out a little bit about the steel band. Is loosely tied into texture, but it's just as much an important instrument to know the existence of and a little bit of its history. Okay, so one thing you're going to notice when you watch this is if you look at the drum itself, you normally expect, you see this little line I drew there, you normally expect low notes on the left, high notes on the right. And one of the interesting things about fitting all the notes on the steel pan is that you have to stagger them. So notes that would be right next to each other on the piano are all the way across from each other on this instrument. So watch as this familiar little tune gets played so you can see how that ends up operating. It takes a completely different muscle memory to play this instrument from any other percussion instrument. This is a video about the person who is widely credited with inventing the steel pan as it exists modernly, a man named Elie Manette, who actually passed away somewhat recently, was on faculty at West Virginia University, worldwide recognition for the contributions he made to this instrument, which is the national instrument or family of instruments from Trinidad. One thing, as you hear him talk about trash cans, keep in mind that Trinidad is off the northern coast of Venezuela, which is known for its oil exports. Back in his day, they didn't have tanker ships. They would have oil barrels. So the trash cans he's talking about were just leftover oil barrels that were sitting around, and just like other found objects that got turned into instruments, it was because they were readily available. This is something, if you want to watch the first 5 minutes of this, just to give you a little extra context, it's not anything I'm going to be quizzing you on, but if you're interested and intrigued in this, it does happen to be the only acoustic musical instrument invented in the 20th century. That's the credit for the steel pan and this family of instruments. So something interesting to learn a little bit more about amongst all these other topics that we keep discussing, you know, left and right with the timbre and texture of music.
I started from a little kid. I was playing trash can and buckets and paint tins, and we call it silly names, kettle drum and doo-doop and boom, and I was at the funny names they called them at the time. And it was one, you know, the rhythm all the time. No kind of melodious sound coming out of them except rhythmic patterns. And from 1935, 1937, 38, around 1938 I came into the picture, 37, 38. Because I saw some older guys playing the trash cans, and I was very intrigued with it all day. So I left school and I went on my father's backyard and I got one of the little trash cans and I started to beat on it. And by beating on it, I could observe I'm getting some of the same kind of rhythm as the other band was getting up the road. And by continuing this today now, all the bands around Port of Spain begin to play trash cans. Trash can. And one gentleman, I understand, I was not there, but I learned, and I always support that statement, that a guy by the name of Winston Spree Simon is the first person that plays melody that comes from one of those cans. It was not what we have today, but the smallest, but he was playing a distinct melody. And the drums at the time was convex. What we have today is a basin. You know, the surface of the drum is a basin. But before that basin, the drum will push them inside, push them up like this. And instead of looking at a basin like this, it was like that. The top of the drum, the surface, this kind of globe. And what they did at the time, I would do also, with that globe, we'll take boom handles and it will dent the top like that. And wherever you dent, you'll create a little song in there. And I saw another guy playing a melody also on the same kind of a top. And it was driving me crazy because they were getting the melody and I couldn't get it. So I said, how come they could get a melody on those convex and I can't do it? I get it in all kind of crazy way. So I decided, you know what? I'm going to sink the drum. And instead of putting a convex and a little dimple, I put a concave with a hump. So the concave, when they push the hump up, you could hit on the hump and control it. So I did that in 1941. And it started from there. And I had a very famous drum, Trinidad knows about it. I called it a very silly name. I called it the Barracuda. And Barracuda, such a bad fish, a night drum at the time, was the baddest drum in Port of Spain. So I called it the Barracuda. So they beat me up one night and took my drum away in Port of Spain. Some other bigger, older band beat me up in Duke Street and took my drum away, 1945. So then I said, I have no drums to play. So then I wanted a drum to play. So that's how I managed to come with a 55 gallon, 46. No disputing of the fact, Eddie Manette built the first 55 gallon drum of a musical instrument. It was crude. You didn't know what you're doing to control the tones, but it was there. And the band began to take shape. The steel band began to, and then it began to take shape, so the government began to realize that the boys are doing something. So they wanted to send us to England to show this new instrument off. So they called a proper musician in to direct us what to do. So they took us to London with the direction of a professor they called Lieutenant Griffith, a band director, and he taught us all about chromatics and harmonics and this and that and whatnot. And from the time I came back from England in 1952, my creation really began. Because I then become knowledgeable about what music terminology is and how to obtain certain depths and range. Come back from England with that in my mind, and I went like wildfire. It's something that there's sensitivity that you have to have. What do you see? How you interpret it? How you strike it? Hand and mind, the coordination, like a painter. Picasso, painting in a dream. You see that way. In other words about it, what do you see as a vision? What do you see? What do you hear? How do you make that song what you want to hear? How? And what with hammers? No keys to tighten. You just hammer. Ball peen of all different sizes and shape. And you have to observe the metal to know what area you have to strike to create patterns. You manipulate the steel from raw metal hard style. You manipulate that steel so it begins to respond. And it begins to respond and vibrate. And when it runs, begin to vibrate, and then you said, well, let me control it. Control the vibration in a different way. And that is not an easy task. It's the hardest education that anybody will ever learn to be a great pan tuner. I work with scientists, engineers, physicists, chemists, metallurgists all around the country. And they said to me, it is the hardest thing that I've ever observed. But to become a creator, you have to design, one. You have to have notation placement, volume of notes, throat length, determination, what area will give you depth of sound, or pitch higher. What resonator length will give you to accommodate that song that you imagine? What is the notation and the harmonic relation that go on a note that respond to each other? All the things that, and not only that, the side of the drum has certain sound. And you have to relay the pitches on top to relate to the side. So all this is a work of a genius in a way. How do you figure it out? And everything I figured out was trial and error. I wrote a song of my life, and I said, I always knew in my heart one day that my work would find its way. I could not tell you how. There was no one there for me to show the way, but I figured it out. I figured it all through for all of you to know to see today. My time in my involvement of 75 years of knocking on cans, it has not been wasted because college kids all around is adapting to it. All I know that I had the vision to see these drums and I fabricated them, hand and mind, put them into practice. Now all I want to do is to pass this skill on to young people so they'll ultimately take it and make it better. Because what I have today, it might be good, but as a perfectionist, it's not good enough.
As I mentioned before, it is a little difficult to hear texture differences in this style of music because everybody is more or less playing full out the whole time. But that's one of the accomplishments when you have instruments that can blend so perfectly together. They can create a very well unified sound. And so the texture starts to, it's the music starts to transcend the texture a little bit. So depending on how homogeneous the instruments are, you may or may not detect a lot of the sounds that are going on, and how individualistic the players are matters less and less the more the instruments are themselves similarly constructed more and more.
Thank you.
As soon as you start talking about multiple things going on, well, then you have to ask yourself, how do they balance with one another? Is there a foreground, a background, a middle ground? Are all of them supposed to be equally important? Normally, when you look at, for example, the framing of a scene in a movie, you can't have everything in focus fully. There has to be something that is more prominent and something that's less prominent. And dynamics are one of the main ways that musicians accomplish this, the ability to focus on one thing. It's basically a relative loudness level. Dynamics in dance refer to much more something along the same lines as saying someone has a dynamic personality. In other words, the capacity for change and different qualities to come across, you know, fast, slow, sharp, smooth. Musician dynamics refer specifically to volume. So it's a little bit more of a narrow definition. And you have a chart there. These are all Italian terms with their translations. Originally, that top one and the bottom one, pianissimo and fortissimo, weren't around. So when you had the time of, you had like, you know, in the 18th century, you had more like forte, mezzo forte, piano, or mezzo piano, piano. And then you got a little bit into the 19th century and you started to move outward. And so until you got, you know, Tchaikovsky would like write four Fs and five Fs, and people started to go a little bit crazy with their dynamic markings. But with this, then you also have terms that are related to it, which have to do with gradually transitioning from one dynamic level to another. So from soft to loud, we hear this word all the time, crescendo. Crescendo is the transition. A lot of times people incorrectly use this word to indicate the peak, as in he reached a crescendo. No, that makes no sense. You're basically saying that you've reached a build. That's technically what they're saying. So if you want to, you know, make sure you sound smart and articulate, use the crescendo to indicate a growing or a gathering or building. That's what that means. And then the opposite is easy to remember, decrescendo or diminuendo, to diminish. Those are different terms that you can use. Now, if you go back and check out the Adagio for Strings score samples that I had a few slides back, you'll actually notice that there are dynamics and what we call hairpins, those little shapes that indicate either a crescendo or diminuendo. You'll notice those are right off the bat in there. See if you can listen to those pieces and hear the relative dynamics. The beginning of that piece is clearly supposed to be very delicate, very distant, very soft. So you're not going to hear the music on those first pages. You're not going to hear the forte, but when the piece later reaches its peak, you will certainly hear, and it's one of the more shrill moments towards the ends when the lower voices drop out and you have all the higher strings really, really crying out. Maybe about two and a half minutes from the end, you'll get to hear a true triple forte or fortissimo or double forte. Sometimes, like if you see two Fs, people say double forte. Means the same thing, basically. And these are all relative statements. They don't mean a specific decibel level. One of the mistakes that early musicians tend to make is they'll assume that mezzo forte in one setting, let's say in a practice room, is the same as mezzo forte on stage, is the same as mezzo forte outside. And that's not at all the case. Mezzo forte doesn't mean 67.5 decibels. It means moderately loud. And that changes depending on what other kind of circumstances you're in, what kind of acoustic surroundings you're in. So just to wrap up the topic of musical texture, Composers and arrangers, when they work on the orchestration, like exactly what's going on when and who's doing what and how things are coordinated, that those precise combinations create someone's signature style in the same way that producers in a recording studio can create their signature style. Again, we're talking about things from the acoustic perspective, but there are analogies that can be made to the electronic. I'm talking acoustic because it's just a little bit more external and it doesn't require quite as much tech talk. You can see someone play an instrument and you, being a fellow human being, can identify at least somewhat with the task of creating sound there. The orchestrator, the arranger, is the person, or the producer in the studio. They are the people who have the last say as to what texture is used, what is going on. So one thing I'll leave you with is sometimes what makes you like a piece of music could be just as much the arrangement, that how the parts are laid on top of each other, as it is the material itself. And if you're after a specific version of a song or a piece of music, you need to make sure it's the same arranger. So don't disregard that part of the metadata on a given song or given track, the arranger. That's just as important in many cases as the composer. One thing that's interesting, in particular, I believe the movie score composer Danny Elfman, my understanding is that he would do a lot of, and he worked with Tim Burton, and he's still writing music quite prolifically. He would write all of his thematic music, you know, like motifs and score and traveling music and transitional music. He would write it on piano, more or less, and then someone else would actually come along and decide what instrument did what. And I'm sure Elfman would have, last say as to what went where, but some of that heavy lifting that created the distinctive sound. And if you go and you listen to any the music in Tim Burton movies, I know it's he hasn't put something out in a bit, but did have definitely a very distinct sound. And that wasn't 100% Elfman. That was as much the people he hired to help orchestrate. So something to leave with you is that texture and timbre, and they're very much tied together, have a lot to do with how effective music can be.